we were talking about, we started the coverage of multimedia freedom systems, right? By first introducing 2-degree of freedom, which, as I said, was the foundation for multimedia freedom analysis, as we'll see more today, that in fact, there's no difference between that and the generalized form. But, you know, as I said, we were not gonna, given especially the time that we had, the time limitation, the scope of the course, we're not gonna go that in depth, like what we did in single degree of freedom, to demonstrate how to model a system as a multi-degree of freedom system, or, you know, various approaches for deriving the equations of motion. All we will be doing is to, as I did last time, we demonstrated how to use classic mechanics, right? Or second law of engineering mechanics or dynamics to derive the equation of motion. Today I'm going to, through an example, demonstrate a method which is very powerful. It's a very general approach for deriving the equations of motion. We're not gonna, of course, derive that Lagrange's equation, but simply demonstrate the application. In fact, Lagrangian dynamics is a class by itself that you may have heard of Lagrangian dynamics, right? No? It's a completely different way to study dynamics, and there's no restriction. Flexible dynamics or flexible body dynamics or mechanical vibrations or rigid body dynamics, doesn't matter. Lagrangian approach can be applied to either one as long as the system is assumed to be conservative or undamped. But we'll just introduce that at least through some example so that you're exposed to it. Who knows, down the road you may want to take some advanced courses and you're interested in continuing studying vibrations. So at least be aware of this, because this is applicable to multi-degree of freedom system, continuous system, discrete system. There is no restriction whatsoever. But what is Lagrange's equation? Lagrange introduced basically this quantity, which we call the Lagrangian or Lagrange's term, that is the difference between the kinetic energy and the potential energy. And through some approach, which, as I said, we cannot go through that because it requires more in-depth knowledge of energy methods and some partial differential equations, demonstrated that if you have a system with what he called generalized coordinates, QIs are called generalized coordinates, that in mechanical vibration we call them degrees of freedom. So a system with I number of degrees of freedom, it can be demonstrated that the equation of motions can be derived by applying this equation. In other words, say for a 2-degree of freedom system, I would be 1 and 2. So for instance, for I equal to 1, means for the degree of freedom 1, you just take the derivative of Laplace Lagrangian with respect to the velocity of that degree of freedom, take the time derivative of that, subtract from it partial derivative of Lagrangian with respect to displacement of that degree of freedom, and same thing with second degree of freedom, and you can derive the equation of motion. So we cannot, of course, prove that here, but at least demonstrate the application of this and how practical and powerful it is as compared with the Mr. Newton's approach, okay? And We can do that through an example, probably. So let's say, as I said, the only limitation is we are dealing with conservative systems. Energy conservative system, that means no damping, no energy loss. So let's say you have a mass, M1, connected to this spring, is moving in this direction. So let's call that degree of freedom U1, and a pendulum is attached to this mass. So this is basically a weightless, inextensible rod, okay, with a length L, and you have a mass, say mass 2, attached to it. So as this mass 1 moves, this mass 2 is going to oscillate, so it moves like this. So you have a translational motion and a rotational motion, which I call that U2. So this system has 2 degrees of freedom. It can be fully described or analyzed by those degrees of freedom. For Lagrange's approach, that's all you have to do. Identify the degrees of freedom, which we call them generalized coordinates, and the rest is so easy. All you have to do, set up the kinetic energy and the potential energy, subtract the two, and perform this equation. So let's do that. In order to find the kinetic energy for the system, would be kinetic energy of obviously mass 1 and mass 2. So what I'll do is to make it easier on myself, let's describe the motion of this mass, okay, in translational coordinates. Or in other words, instead of dealing with the rotational motion, let's say these are the positions of mass 2 as this moves. Zx and zy coordinates describe the location or the displacement of mass 2 with respect to x and y. So kinetic energy then for the system would be simply the kinetic energy of mass 1, which is m1 u1 dot squared, plus the kinetic energy of mass 2. What is the kinetic energy of mass 2? Would be, if these are the displacements, would be zx dot squared plus zy dot squared, because these are the velocities with respect to x and y, right? But that's not what I need. I need that expression to be in terms of the degrees of freedoms u1 and u2. So how do you do that? Zx, if you look at that, is what? And I'm going to draw that here, or enlarge that here. If this is mass 2, okay, this is the original position of mass 2. This is L. This is u2, right? So, Zx would be then u1, whatever displacement mass 1 goes through, plus this. But what is that? That is L sine of U2, right? So it would be U1 plus L sine U2, okay? And what is then ZX dot? If that is ZX, I need ZX derivative of that, right? So that would be simply what? U1 dot plus L U2 dot cosine U2. Sine of U would be U dot cosine of U, right? How about ZY? ZY is simply this. In other words, this is ZY, right? So ZY is this. This is ZY, which is L cosine of U2. So ZY is just simply L cosine U2. Therefore, Z dot Y is negative L, right, U2 dot sine of U2. That's it. So now I have ZX and ZY in terms of U and U1 and U2, substitute that in that equation and find the kinetic energy. And since I've done it here, I'm just gonna write it down. So you, if you do that, your total kinetic energy, right, you need to square this, right, and square this, add them up, performs a little bit of algebra there, so that will lead to this equation. 1/2 M1 U1 dot squared plus 1/2 M2 times U1 dot squared plus L squared U1 dot squared, I'm sorry, U2 dot squared plus 2L U1 dot U2 dot cosine of U2. That's what you end up with, okay? So that's the reason for that is you also end up with sine squared plus cosine squared if you factor things out, which is one. So a little bit, I'm skipping maybe two steps of algebraic manipulation. So that is kinetic energy, right? Now in order to find or set up L, I also need to evaluate the potential energy. But what is the potential energy? Potential energy is the potential energy of this spring plus the potential energy of this mass, right? But what is the potential energy of that mass? This mass moves, right, from here to here. And but what is that distance? That is L minus this, which is L times cosine of U2. So this is L minus L cosine U2, or L times 1 minus cosine U2, right? So potential energy then would be 1/2 of K U1 squared for the spring plus mg L times 1 minus cosine U2. So that is the potential energy, right? So L then would be, although it's a long expression, let's write them down. 1/2 M1 U1 dot squared plus 1/2 M2 times U1 dot squared plus L squared U2 dot squared plus 2L U1 dot U2 dot cosine U2, okay, minus 1/2 K U1 squared minus M G L times 1 minus cosine U2. So this is L, okay? So now all you have to do, just apply that equation, right? In order to do that, let me first of all erase this because it's taking some space that I need here, okay? So all you need to do, look at that equation. You apply that for each degree of freedom. So you need to evaluate these terms. Partial derivative of L with respect to U1 dot, partial derivative of L with respect to U2 dot, that then you need to take the time derivative of these, right? Then you need partial derivative of L with respect to U1, and then partial derivative of L with respect to U2. Then you substitute these into that equation, right? So let's just start with this one. So partial derivative of this with respect to U dot one means everything else except U1 dot is a number, right? Partial derivative. So you have two U1 dot times M1, so you get this for this case. You get M1, U1 dot, right? And then you get M2 times U1 dot, okay? And everything else is, this is zero. This would be 2L U2 cosine U2. So you have plus M2L U dot 2. Or actually cosine of U dot 2. Let me create more space here. So it would be plus M2L cosine of U 2. Given that, as you see, Lagrange's approach does not restrict you to small angles, large angles, doesn't matter. But since you're dealing with linear systems, we're going to suffice to linear system, I would assume U2 is very small. So this would be almost 1, right? So this can be simplified to M1 plus M2 times U1 dot plus M2L, M2L, okay? That's it. So that's M2L, U dot 2, because I forgot to put actually U dot 2 here, okay? So that's the simple form, or simplified form for this, right? Now, how about this one? You just take the derivative, partial derivative, with respect to U2 dot, that means this is zero, this would be zero, and so on. This is zero, this is zero. So if you do that, you get M2 L squared U2 dot plus M2 L U1 dot cosine of U2. Again, assuming that this is equal is 1, small angles, this becomes simply just M2 L squared U2 dot plus M2 L U1 dot. So that's that term, okay? Again, of course, you need to do what? Now, you need to find partial of L with respect to U1. So take the derivative of this with respect to U1. What you will find would be, if you want to take the derivative of partial derivative of this with respect to U1, everything else is a constant. So all of these disappear, so it's only this term, right? So that would give you minus K U1, that's it. And partial of L with respect to U2, the same. Everything is a constant except U2, so you only have this term. So you end up with minus M2 L U1 dot U2 dot sine of U2 minus M2 G L sine U2. Okay. Assuming again small angle, sine of U2 becomes almost equal to U2. And product of these two, in other words, a quadratic term, assuming that U is a small, U1 dot times U2 dot is very, very small, so we can ignore this. So this becomes only minus M2 G L U2.
Why is that equal to zero?
See, if you have a small value, right? So let's say this is 0.5, this is 0.2, right? Got 0.01, right? So it's very, very small, right? Mm-hmm. So if you make the approximation that these values are small, all the quadratic term would be negligible, basically, okay? So now all you have to do, just take the time derivative of this, and for the first equation, in other words, for I equal to 1, or for U1, right, take the time derivative of this, which would be M1 plus M2, U1 double dot, right?
Okay.
Well, anyway, so let's just start that again.
Don't
so,
they know we're doing...
Probably, yeah, who knows? Yeah, they're trying to help you guys, I guess.
Trying to help you.
So, taking the derivative, time derivative of this, that would be M2 L U2 double dot, right? Minus this, right? So plus KU1, right, is equal to zero. That's the first term, okay? And the second term, okay, let me fix all these, okay? The second term, okay, becomes taking the derivative of this with respect to time. So for U2, then you have M2 L squared U2 double dot, right, plus M2 L U1 double dot, right, then this one plus MG L U2 is equal to zero. And therefore, okay, this is the simultaneous set of the equations of motion. So you can imagine, now you see how powerful Lagrange's approach or Lagrange's equation for deriving the equations of motion are. Without any limitation, if we had left even these approximations instead of them, the original terms, you would end up, of course, with a nonlinear equation. But if you wanted to solve that problem using the Newtonian approach, it would be far more difficult. This way, all you did, define the degrees of freedom, identify the kinetic and potential energy, basically derive the Lagrangian, and that's it. So hopefully someday you get to learn more about Lagrange himself and Lagrange's contributions to dynamic systems, okay? So with that said then, let's go back to where we were. And that was what? Multi-degree of freedom systems continued. Any questions? So we were talking about multi-degree of freedom system, right? And, okay, put it here because otherwise the wind is gonna blow them away. So if you look at the equations of motion that we derive for a 2-degree of freedom system, right, that would be this, for a 2-degree of freedom system, you can see that we can easily write those equations in an alternative form by using the matrix formulation or the matrix notation. And if you do that, those two equations can be written like this. 0, M2, okay, times U1 double dot, U2 double dot, plus C1 plus C2 minus C2 minus C2 C2 U1 dot U2 dot plus K1 plus K2 minus K2 minus K2 K2 U1 U2 is equal to F1 minus M1 Y double dot, F2 minus M2 Y double dot. In other words, for a system that we had, which which was this, C1, M1. M2, as we defined that, right? And then we had considered even a base displacement of yt that we derived the equation of motion. In your notes, as you see, we had these two equations, M1 times U1 double dot plus C1 plus C2 times U1 dot minus C2 times U2 dot plus K1 plus K2 U1 minus K2 U2 is equal to F1 minus M1 dot Y double dot. The second equation was M2 U2 double dot minus C2 U1 dot C2 U2 dot minus K2 U1 plus K2 U2 is equal to F2 minus M2 Y double dot. So what I did, all I did was just rewrote them in matrix notation. The advantage of this matrix notation is that this is really, if we express this in general form, what we will do, the procedure we use for solving these matrix equations would be similar for any degree, for a system with any number of degrees of freedom. What we call this matrix is, we call that mass matrix. For a multi-degree of freedom system, discrete system, mass matrix is always a diagonal matrix, meaning that you have only terms along the diagonal, M1, M2, and so on, rest is zero. Okay. This is a vector, you know, a vector from, you know, matrix algebra, you remember. A vector is a one-dimensional matrix, right? So this is a vector of acceleration input, or acceleration vector. This is damping matrix. Which we show that like this. This is the stiffness matrix. So the stiffness matrix. And this is the vector of the forcing functions. Okay. This is one type of notation used for matrices. Another notation, which actually makes it easier, you know, basically just for the sake of simplicity, write these equations. Instead of using this bracket, you can use this notation. So I can rewrite that equation in this form. C U dot plus K U is equal to F. So this is U dot matrix. U double dot. This is the U dot matrix, and this is U vector or matrix. So as you can see now, for a two-degree or multi-degree of freedom system, the problem is reduced to solving this matrix differential equations, except the difference between this and single degree of freedom system is that these equations are coupled. And we will see, of course, how later we decouple them. But studying multi-degree of freedom systems basically is reduced down to the same sort of categories that we have seen in single degree of freedom systems. In other words, we're going to see how we solve this equation when we have a free, undamped system, or free vibration of undamped system. That means disk would disappear and the right-hand side would be zero. Free vibration of damped system. Then we have the forced vibration of undamped and forced vibration of damped systems. So these are the four categories that we are going to study.
Okay.
Any questions? Okay. So how are we going to pursue that? Before I begin discussing these categories, I'm going to take, again, a very short sidetrack and just expose you, at least, like what we did with Lagrange's equation, at least expose you to a very important concept, which basically is the way to solve large matrix differential equations. You'll see that in much more in-depth in the course that if you take system dynamics, Professor Bill Murray is teaching it. How many of you are planning to take system dynamics? I highly recommend it. Great course. But anyway, so at least let's expose you to what it means. As you can see, this is a matrix equation, differential equation of second order. Most cases, especially when this, we have a large matrices, obviously we will solve this numerically. So solving a second order equation is not obviously easy for a variety of reasons depending on the nature of these matrices and so on. But it's many times easier to convert that second order differential equation to first order. The procedure we use is called the state space formulation. State space formulation. As I said, I would just briefly mention that and will suffice only to that brief coverage. So what we do, we introduce two vectors, z1 and z2, which we call them state space vectors. z1 is u1, u2, and z2 is u1 dot and u2 dot. Or in other words, make vector z, which is z1, z2, is this vector u1, u2, u1 dot, u2 dot. Okay? So with that description or in mind, let's look at that equation. What I will do, our objective is to solve that equation. So what I will do first, I would pre-multiply that equation by the inverse of mass matrix. Remember from your matrix algebra that if you have a matrix like matrix A, if you pre-multiply this matrix by itself, what is the outcome? Identity matrix, right? Like the equivalent of the analogous to that is scalar product, right? If you multiply 1/2 by 2 is always 1, right? So that's what I do. So I'm going to pre-multiply that. So inverse of m times mu double dot becomes just simply u double dot, because identity matrix times the matrix is the matrix itself, right? And I take the rest of them to the right-hand side. So I end up with inverse of mass matrix times c, okay, u1 dot minus inverse k u plus inverse times f, right? So this is an alternative form of writing the equation of motion. But let's now substitute though for those space, state space vectors. You can see that U double dot is basically Z2 dot. So Z2 dot is minus M. Yeah, it's persistent. So C times U dot, which is Z2 minus inverse M K, U is Z1 plus M inverse F. So as you can see now, the problem is reduced to solving a first order instead of second order differential equation, and it's a lot easier to perform this integration. And once you solve for Z1 and Z2, you have basically what? You have both the displacement and the velocity solutions. And that's the beauty of state space formulation. I can go in more in-depth, showing you how you actually set up these matrices and partition them and whatnot, but that's beyond the scope of this course. I thought just suffice the coverage to this extent, and hopefully, if you're interested, you can pick it up from there. Now, with that said, so let's now start those categories, right? So we're going to start with free vibration of undamped systems. Okay. So looking at the general form of the equation, which I have there, right? If you have no damping, that damping matrix is zero. And so the system is simply reduced down to what? M1 in the scalar form, U1 double dot, plus K1 plus K2, right, times U1 minus K2, U2 is equal to zero. And the second equation would be M2 U2 double dot, right, minus K2 U1 plus K2 U2 is equal to zero. So these are the equations of motion, right, that we want to solve. Similar to single degree of freedom systems, that we assumed at least one way of solving the problem was that for a linear second order homogeneous differential equation, the solution to free vibration or to this homogeneous equation is always, can be assumed, that is of a harmonic form, right? We make the same assumption here. That is, we say U1 would be something like this, and U2 would be something like this. So we substitute these back into the equation in order to find A1, A2, and omega, as we did last time, or the single degree of freedom systems. If you do that substitution, okay, and equate everything is equal to zero, it turns out that just all you will be dealing with, or you need to find, is the amplitudes. In other words, you end up with these equations. So you need to take the second derivative of this, plus this time the first, and so on. So you simplify that, you get negative omega squared M1 plus K1 plus K2, okay, times A1 minus K2. A2 is equal to zero, because the sine omega t is not going to be equal to zero, so only the coefficient would be zero, minus omega squared M2 A2 plus K2, A1, plus K2, A2 is equal to zero. So the problem is reduced to solving these two equations, or this set of simultaneous equations, right? From, again, matrix algebra or whatever calculus, you remember that if you have a homogeneous set of equations, okay, this does not have a unique solution. In fact, A1 and A2 are not, cannot be independent. You cannot find the value of these. You can only find the ratio of these two parameters. The reason for that is that in order to solve, how did you solve a set of simultaneous equations? There are different methods, but one of them was what? Cramer's rule, right? So if you had a system of equation like A1x1 plus B1x2 is equal to zero, A2x2 plus B2x2 is equal to zero, okay? You have a, basically something like this, AX plus BX equal to zero, okay? And the way to solve this solution for each of these, or for any of these would be, for instance, for X1, would be the determinant of the that consists of this plus the coefficients divided by the determinant of the coefficients, okay? In other words, the matrix A1, A, and so on and so forth. So since this is zero, obviously any matrix with one row is equal to zero, in order for this to have an answer, this has to be zero. Otherwise, everything would be zero. So the condition for this equation to have a non-zero or non-trivial solution is that the determinant of the coefficients have to be zero. I don't know if you remember that from matrix algebra, but if you don't, just accept that, right? That in order for a homogeneous equation to have an answer, the determinant of coefficients has to be zero. So we'll pick it up from here next time. See what that implies.